My name is Sherri Hendrix. I am the registrar at the university, so you guys would never have me for a class or anything like that at this point, maybe someday. But right now, I just work in the registrar's office, the university registrar, so if you ever need anything from the registrar's office, you can come see me. We're good. How many of you are, what is your interest in this session in particular? Is there just like, this is the best one of all of them, or I don't know this person, so I kind of wanted to hear somebody I don't usually hear, or what is your reason? Anybody want to give me your reason for coming to this? It sound like an interesting session. Do you even know what it's about? Yes. Okay. Thank you. Whether that's true or not, we'll see. Anyway, I wanted to start with an introduction of what I'm going to talk about, if this will let me do it. Basically, this is kind of a testimony of some things that have happened in my life and to my family. And it took us from a place of very ordered life to kind of a chaotic situation and then reordering us back. And most of it is in terms of my relationship and my family's, my husband's, and my relationship with God and how we interpreted and understood God before this event, and then how we interpret God through the event, and then how we interpret God after the event. So basically, this presentation is how we went from ordered to chaos back to reordered in our relationship with God. First of all, before the chaos, the order that we were in, my husband and I were good kids all the way through. We were church kids. We grew up in the church. And we felt like God blessed us because we were good kids. Like nothing bad ever happened to us. You know, some minor things, you know, occasionally, you know, hurt ourselves in a, you know, hurt my leg or whatever, but nothing like major. We just really felt like we were blessed. And because we obeyed God, we were in that kind of that model, that order. The order was we obey, God blesses. So we were kind of, these were the definitions of order that I pulled that seemed to kind of exemplify who we were as people. A state in which laws and rules regulating public behavior are observed and authority is obeyed. And that was kind of my husband and myself. We obeyed our parents. We obeyed the church. We, you know, we did everything. We obeyed God. We did everything that we were supposed to do. And then the second definition, a state in which everything is in its correct and appropriate place. And that was kind of, you know, everything just was as it should be. Life was just, it wasn't like a fairy tale life, but it was just as it should be. Our relationship with God sort of followed this definition of order. The arrangement or disposition of people or things, so my husband and I, our arrangement in relation to each other, everything in our lives was blessed. That was kind of the arrangement according to a particular sequence, pattern, or method. And because we loved and obeyed God and did everything according to what we knew was expected for us as Christians, that was the order and the pattern and the method. So that was our order. We obeyed, God blessed. So, because we were good things, nothing ever happened to us. We obeyed, God blessed. So, let me just tell you a little bit about Steve and myself so you kind of get to know us, what I mean by we were good kids. My husband, his grandfather was a lifetime pastor, and he actually became the director of our world missions for our denomination. I'm a Church of the Nazarene is my denomination, and so his grandfather was over all of the world missions over the whole world. So he has that heritage and that legacy. His other grandparents were lifetime missionaries. They first served in Cuba before Castro came and took over, and they had to evacuate suddenly and out of, you know. And then they went to Argentina and were lifetime parents. And my husband's father grew up on the mission field. He actually, his first language was Spanish. And he was about as white as Rob Kingsley sitting back there in that that corner. So it was kind of an amazing thing to hear him. I mean, just eloquent Spanish. My husband, you can see a little arrow over there. My husband is on the far end. His name is Steve. And he attended a Christian college, attended Mid-America Nazarene University. He traveled with the PR singing group. He's got a great singing voice still to this day. He was student body president. He majored in religion and ministry. Things were just going along as they should be. When I met him, he was actually the youth pastor at my home church. So I have the church, you can see There's Jim Cummins, Alan Queen, J. Lester Seal, Don Hastings, Steve Hendrix. That's his name. He was the youth pastor when we met. So things were in order and as they should be. Me, I was in church from the time I was born. I was an evangelist when I was 8 years old. My family traveled in a big green bus and we sang in churches and my dad preached. And I have an album that you never want to hear. I was a Bible quizzer, one of the top. I went to regionals and, you know, hotsy-totsy. I was a youth group leader. I was always on our youth council, planned stuff. I was a straight-A student, and then I attended a Christian college, Olivet Nazarene University, and I was a cheerleader, and I was on the traveling drama group, and I just very involved. Life was as it should be, just according to the pattern. Together, Steve and I, we met. Steve's a little bit older than me. He's 5 years older. But we, you know, our dating relationship was as it should be. We did all the rules, you know, the right rules. No sex before marriage. We were engaged for a while. Then we got married. And although we did get engaged after 6 weeks, just so you know. That was kind of out of order. But we knew. We just celebrated our 30th anniversary. So just so you know, it worked. It was okay. It worked out well. We moved to Kansas City for my husband to go to seminary, and we both got jobs without even interviewing. We just were offered jobs. It was like, you know, life is as it should be, just going along. We were good kids. Life is as it should be. And then we waited a little while to have kids. We waited almost 4 years before we had any children, and I got pregnant on the first try. Life was as it should be, just ordered and wonderful. Then chaos happened, and I don't know if you can see that definition of chaos, but the definition I pulled from the Merriam-Webster website was a state of utter confusion. Now, the initial instance of this didn't throw us into utter confusion, so wait for it. But this is the event. Now, this is the day that I went to have my son. Okay. I'm huge. It looks like I'm having triplets, and I'll explain why in just a second. When I got pregnant, it was a delight. We were so happy. We were excited, you know, got the little plus sign thing from the doctor. And then I went along with my pregnancy, went to all of my doctor's visits as I should normally do. Everything was progressing as it should. Life was ordered. Things were great. And then at 28 weeks, I went to the doctor, and he was puzzled. And he said, you know, I want to run some tests on you. And I said, what's going on? And he said, well, you're measuring a little bit further along than you should. And I said, what could that be caused by? He goes, so there's a lot of different things. So we're just going to run you through a battery of tests to make sure that everything's okay, that you're on track. So I took a bunch of, you know, gestational diabetes where you have to drink this awful orange liquid. It's terrible. And they put me through a non-stress test where they listened to the baby's heart. And I mean, just all kinds of tests that they put me through. I can't even remember all of them. They have put me through so many. And they all came up fine. So I went back to my doctor's visit at 32 weeks. And then I was measuring 4 weeks beyond what I should be. And the doctor was like, I think that there may be something wrong with a baby. But this is not as life should be. Suddenly, there was confusion. Like, wait a minute. What do you mean there's something wrong with a baby? So at that time, you girls, when you have your babies, they do sonograms now regularly. It's kind of one of those things that they do. But when I was pregnant, they did not do it unless there was a problem, unless they thought there may be a problem. So we did a sonogram, and the doctor called me. When the doctor calls you, himself and not his nurse, you know something's wrong. So the doctor called me, and And he said, we found something in the baby's abdomen. We don't know what it is. And so we're going to send you to a specialist. So I went to the specialist. The specialist didn't know what it was. But he did give us three things that it could be. First was a twisted bowel. That's easily fixed. Surgery could fix it, no problem. The second thing was a tumor. Easy to fix, take it out, no problem. Third thing was what's called meconium ileus. And it is a symptom of what happens when the baby's first poo kind of perforates into the abdominal sac. And so, but the 90% of the cases of meconium ileus are caused by cystic fibrosis, which is a genetic disease. So we never thought in our lives, and as parents, this didn't follow the pattern or order of everything was good and everything was okay. But we were praying for a tumor. We were praying that it wasn't meconium ileus, because then that would mean a lifetime of having to deal with a disease that we were not sure. And things were out of order. We weren't parents yet, but we were parents. And we were trying to figure out how to deal with all of this, with this baby that we didn't even have yet. And we were suddenly, things were not in order. Things were starting to be confusing and chaotic. So we started to research a little bit about cystic fibrosis when we found out what that it could possibly be that. And so I'm going to play you this video. It's about a 5-minute video, just so that you have an understanding of what cystic fibrosis is, okay? And of course the speakers aren't working, so hang on. I have my own speakers that I tested in my office that I brought, because I have done presentations before where I know that things don't work right.
Nearly 11,000 in the UK, and in the UK each... Now that's a question. Cystic fibrosis is, well, a lot of different things to a lot of different people. Nearly 11,000 in the UK, and in the UK each week 2 people die from CF and 5 more babies are born with it. Which probably means a lot of you are watching this in search of answers to that big question. So, let's get started. Cystic fibrosis is about genetics. You can't catch it. But if both your parents have the CF gene, there's a 1 in 4 chance you'll be born with the condition. About 1 in 25 people carry the gene, and most don't even know it. And I should say at the start, there's currently no getting rid of it. All sounds a bit gloomy, right? But whilst there's no cure, a lovely life is still possible. Just look at me. You see, I have CF, so I think I'm a good person to tell you a little bit more about it. Cystic fibrosis is caused by a faulty gene that disrupts the movement of salt and water in the body's cells, making the mucus in people with CF thicker and stickier. This sticky mucus causes problems, mainly in the lungs and digestive system, but also affects other parts of the body too. It's not nice. The small airways in the lungs can get clogged up with this mucus, causing infections and, over time, damage to the lungs. So, what does all that mean for everyday life? Well, here are some of the symptoms. Frequent chest infections, severe or prolonged coughs, wheezing or shortness of breath, abnormal bowel movements, difficulty gaining weight, and for most men, infertility. There's also the issue of never being able to meet up with anyone else with CF. Basically, we could make each other unwell because of the bugs and infections that get transmitted between people with the condition. For better or worse, CF is a part of me. It may be an unhealthy relationship, but there are a lot of daily treatments to tackle cystic fibrosis effectively, which can make our union that bit more harmonious. A whole host of antibiotics to fight infections in my lungs. They're not all that colourful, but you get the idea. Physiotherapy to help shift the mucus that builds up around my organs. Enzyme capsules to take with food. They're really not that hard to swallow. And talking of food, we need a special high-fat diet to make sure our bodies get all the nutrients that it needs. And more drugs to thin that sticky mucus. People with CF sometimes need to take over 40 tablets a day. It's a burden for sure, but it's the preferred option. If conventional treatments no longer work, a lung transplant might be needed. Cystic fibrosis presents daily compromises and challenges, but with careful management and the right treatment, people with CF can lead full and happy lives. Work, travel, family, it's all possible. Recent figures suggest that half of people with CF will live past their 47th birthday. But it's also thought that a baby born today with cystic fibrosis could live longer as life expectancy continues to increase with the amazing advances in treatment and care. So, what is cystic fibrosis? It's a serious condition, but one that an army of people out there are very serious about beating for good.
When we learned that this could be cystic fibrosis, we did a lot of research. When we started looking at cystic fibrosis and what it meant, in 1992, when I was pregnant, the life expectancy wasn't quite as high as he said in the video. It was around 27. But increases in therapies and treatments and things like that, it has raised. But we didn't have any, it was a genetic disease. We didn't know of anybody in our families that had cystic fibrosis or any distant relative, nobody. We had no history of it, so we're like, nah, that can't be it. And then second, there was the order. You know, we obey, God bless us, even though this sort of circumstance sort of threw a wrench in that, but we still were believing the best. We were still thinking, you know, this isn't what it's going to be. God blesses us because we obey. We're good kids. We're still good kids. But then the real confusion began because my son was born on June 22nd, 1992. And these are some pictures of him in the neonatal ICU after he was born, because that thing that was in his stomach, they had to do surgery on the next day after he was born. So he was a one-day-old baby and had surgery. They took the thing out of his abdomen, and it was meconium ileus, which is the thing that causes CF. Now, in my mind, I'm thinking, well, it's only 90% of the cases. So there's still that 10% chance, because we obey and God blesses. So there's still that 10% chance that God is not going to let this be CF. And when my husband came to talk to me, because my son was at the Children's Hospital in Kansas City, and I was at another hospital at St. Luke's. They were about a half an hour apart, so my husband had to travel between hospitals to see us, which was very taxing on him. But he came to tell me the morning of my son's surgery, there were 25 family and friends gathered in the waiting room to support my husband. I'm getting ready to get choked up. And before they took my son into surgery, my husband kissed him. And he told me that one of the nurses that was a friend of the family, she wasn't actually on duty that day. She actually came to be with them, to pray, said that, you know, he was explaining that it could be, you know, whatever it was, if it was meconium ileus, you know, cystic fibrosis. She goes, oh, it's probably not cystic fibrosis. You would know it when you kiss him, because he'll taste salty. And so when my husband kissed him, he said he tasted like an ocean, like he had just come out of the ocean. So it was that moment where we realized this is probably what we're looking at. And in the neonatal ICU, they began treatments on him as if he had cystic fibrosis. So he started taking the enzymes for digestion. He started doing the breathing treatments. They had to percuss him, which is they had to like pound on him a little bit with this little cup they had. And we had to learn how to do all that. And it was just confusing. It was like, wait a minute. We obey, God blesses. What happened? This is not supposed to be. this is confusing. We were in a state of utter confusion. Like, how could this be? Why is this happening to us? Why did God allow this? What is going on? Suddenly, our relationship with God did not make sense anymore. Then, a new form of chaos happened, which follows this definition. This chaos, the property of a complex system whose behavior is so unpredictable as to appear random, owing to great sensitivity to small changes in conditions. This is the next step of chaos for us, was that the complex system was our relationship with God. That was the complex system that we had to try to figure out through all of this. But it was susceptible to, the behavior of that relationship was susceptible to these random sort of unpredictable events that happened. And I'm going to talk about each of these events. And in throughout these events, then, our relationship with God began to reorder. We began to feel a different understanding of our relationship with God. So let me take you through the first event. Event number one. This is a picture I got online of a 1988 Hyundai XL hatchback, which was our car at the time. My husband was driving it home from the day after my son's surgery, after seeing me and then driving home, and just everything, all of his anger and all of his frustration and everything that he had been experiencing to that point just came out. And he started screaming at the top of his lungs, 1 o'clock in the morning, sitting at a red light, no one else was around him, screaming at the top of his lungs at God, why did you do this? What is it that you're doing? I don't understand. This is not fair. This is not right. This is not our deal. We obey you, bless. What happened here? And he said, in that, he called me, and in that moment, well, he came to see me the next day. We didn't have cell phones back then. He came to see me the next day, and he told me, last night I had this experience, and I wanted to share it with you. And he said, I was screaming with God, and all of a sudden, I felt like God was giving me a hug and a slap at the same time, where he hugged me and slapped me at the same time. And this is what he experienced. He started thinking about the passage of scripture in Job. I don't know if you guys know the story of Job, but this was this man who was very faithful to God, and God and the devil struck a deal, which, you know, whatever. But all these bad things started happening to Job, who was this faithful guy, and he was really angry at God and questioning God. And chapters 38 through 40 of Job, God comes back to Job and says, basically, who do you think you are? Who do you think you are asking me these questions? So I just took some of the scripture and said, you know, who is it that questions my wisdom with such ignorance? Brace yourself like a man, because I have some questions for you, and you just may have to answer them. Where were you when I laid the foundations of the earth? Tell me, if you know so much, who determined its dimensions and stretched out the surveying lines? What support is its foundation, and who laid its cornerstone? As the morning stars sang together and all of the angels shouted for joy. So God's basically saying to Job, who are you to ask me these questions? Who are you to be upset with me? You don't know anything. Your understanding is this minuscule. So God goes on for two chapters asking these kinds of questions. You should read these chapters. Those are very interesting. But he finally, at the end of chapter 40, basically says, do you still want to argue with the Almighty? You are God's critic, but do you have the answers? And suddenly my husband felt that hug and that slap and realized, I don't have the answers. I don't know what God is doing. I'm confused. I'm utterly confused. But God does have the answers. I have to trust. It's hard when you're in the midst of all that. But we realized that God was hurting as much as we were. I mean, after all, he had a son that went through suffering and pain, and he had to watch his son suffer. He empathized with us. He knew our pain. He understood. And we knew that he did. And we realized that God really probably loved our son more than we did. That the sacrifice that he gave of his son demonstrated so much love for our son we knew that he was going to take care of him. We knew that he was going to take care of us. It was hard, but that was the first sort of incremental move that we made to reorder. God came and slapped and hugged my husband at the same time. Event number two was our experience in the neonatal ICU. I don't know if you all have ever been into a neonatal ICU, but there are tiny babies, dozens of tiny babies that have so many different problems. It's unbelievable how many problems can happen in babies. We had one little incident, but there was another family that had a little baby who had a heart in her heart had a hole, but the hole was actually keeping her alive because some chambers were switched around, and if she didn't have the hole, then she would have died, and they were trying to figure out how to fix her. Like, what baby can ever come out whole and good? And what baby ever could be normal and not have any problems? So our questions started to be not why us, but why not us? I mean, all of these problems with these babies happened in this neonatal ICU. And it made us remember that scripture in Psalm where it talks about God knitting us together, making us whole, that his works are wonderful. And how can we ever question that? God formed us in this secluded area. He formed our son. He knows our son intimately. So if he knows our son intimately, he knows what's going to go on with him. He knows what's going to happen. And we realized in that moment that any baby born without problems is a real miracle. That's the real miracle. And again, God loves our son. He knows him so well. He knows that there could be any problems. God created Christian with random, chaotic genetic selection, because they all come together genetically chaotic. We don't know what genes are going to come together. We can't predict that. And then we also realized if those particular genes didn't come together the way they did, we wouldn't have Christian. It would be a different baby altogether. And that was really something amazing when you think about all those genes came together in the right way to produce this being, this person. And even though there's a mutation, even though this child has cystic fibrosis, he's our child, he's our son, he is Christian, he's our baby. And we are thankful. Again, another incremental step toward our reorder. Random event number three. This was probably the biggest one. Just a second, I gotta get a drink. I'll just let you ruminate on that picture for a minute. At the time Christian was born, my husband and I were serving as resident directors on Mid-America Nazarene University College campus. And it was the summer, obviously, but I don't know if you can see the date on the far side over there. It says June 27th, 1992. Do you remember when my son was born? June 22nd. So 5 days after my son was born, there was a tragic car accident with two students from Mid-America Nazarene and one girl who was home from Olivet Nazarene, that's in Illinois, and she was with them in the car. And the driver of the car, the three were in the car, the driver turned left, and there was a car coming on. He swore that the headlights, the guy did not have his headlights on, they didn't see him. They were in a car, he was in a big four-wheeler pickup truck, smashed into him. And Robbie Jones was one of those he was on the left-hand side and was killed instantly by this car accident. Robbie was a baseball player. He was very talented. He was bright. He was part of the leadership of the school. He was one of those kids that you just look at and go, wow. And as a matter of fact, they named the baseball field after him. So there's still a memorial of Robbie Jones 30 years later at Mid-America Nazarene University. It's the Robbie Jones baseball field. So Robbie. The girl that was in the car, I know you can't read that very well. Her name was Kendra Seaman. Her parents were lifetime missionaries in the Ivory Coast. She was in the middle, and she had such severe brain trauma. She was in the hospital for months and months, and they didn't know if she was ever going to make it. They lost her several times on the table, and they weren't sure she was going to make it. But her parents were faithful missionaries. Her dad actually became the district superintendent of the Michigan Nazarene District for the Church of the Nazarene. He just recently passed away, but her, you know, faithful family, great. She has a wonderful testimony about when she died. She had an out of body experience, kind of a heaven experience. Heaven is for real. I don't know if you guys have ever seen that, but she had. Anyway, she was laying in the hospital June 27th, and her mother sent us this beautiful card that basically said, "We are never more vulnerable than when it comes to the wellness of our children." And this woman who had her daughter lying near dead in this hospital, writing us this beautiful note to tell us God is faithful. Sorry. God is faithful. He's there through the tragedies, through the hardship. It was the most meaningful. I wish I actually went by, tried to find that. I'm sure I kept it. I was trying to find it for this presentation to show you, but I couldn't find it. The box. We're kind of in transition of houses right now, so it's all packed away in a box. So I couldn't find it, but I wanted to bring it to you to show you this note. It's so beautiful. But this accident helped us to remember that life is fleeting. We can say we're going to go here or there and make plans for our lives and have everything in order, but we never know. Everything is unpredictable. Life can throw us unpredictability and chaos like that. And what we learned from that was this. We realized that there are no guarantees for any of us. The fact that Christian had cystic fibrosis is pretty much irrelevant because we could lose him from anything at any moment. He could have been crossing the street, he could cross the street and get hit by a car and done. He could contract some other kind of illness and die. We just don't know what's going to happen in life. And so for us to be all frustrated and upset about cystic fibrosis, well, we really need to treasure the moments that we have because we don't know what's going to happen next. We don't know. Life is completely unpredictable. And we realize there is no order. We realize there is no order. The last thing that we had, this random event, we were just sitting and listening to some music in our car as we were traveling. And you guys, I don't know if you know Stephen Curtis Chapman or if he's way before your time, or but he had this beautiful song that he played, and it's called Higher Ways. And I have it. If you'll listen to part of it, I won't play the whole song, but I want you to listen to just a little part of it.
At your feet, my home, my pastor.
So if you couldn't hear those words there, your higher ways teach me to trust you. Your higher ways are not like mine. Your higher ways are the ways of a father hiding his children in his love. And teach me to trust you. That was the phrase that we really took out. And it reminded us, obviously, these words were taken directly from Isaiah. For my thoughts are not your thoughts, neither are your ways my ways, declares the Lord. As the heavens are higher than the earth, so my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. And we realized in that moment that we don't always understand what God is doing. We sometimes tend to put him in a box and say, this is the order and obey pattern that should happen, but God may be doing something different. And we don't know. We can't see what God has for the future. We can't see what God has ordained for us. We can't see the things that are there in our lives. So all we have to, and it's not our job to understand. It's not really our job to understand. That song is like, I could ask you all these questions, but really, it's really just my job to trust you. Because I don't know. I don't know everything that you have for me. Come on. Okay, so all of these random occurrences, all these events, there are more, by the way, there are more little random events that kind of moved us incrementally along and helped us discover new things about God in a new way and helped move us. They're hard to kind of, they're really personal, so they're kind of hard to describe in a presentation. But just know, those were the four main big events. And then incrementally along, different things happened to kind of still inch us away. It was this complex system of our relationship with God coming into form in a different way because of the chaos. So through that chaos, through those random unpredicted events, we could have never predicted that we would come up, that an accident would happen, or that all these babies in the neonatal ICU would impact us in the way, or this song, or what, all these things that came together, sort of, they were chaos in themselves. And God used chaos to help us come through the chaos. And on the other side of it, we came to a reorder. So basically, our reorder, our still, we obey and God blesses. You're like, what? Wait, that was the ordered. Well, it's still the order. The order is we obey and God blesses, but we define blessing a little bit differently than we did before. And that was what incrementally moved our relationship with God. It's not we obey and so everything is cool and good in our lives. No, that's not the that's not what it is. Obedience is the blessing in itself. It takes the heat off of us. We trust, and then we can have peace because God, we know that God's got it under control, regardless of what happens, bad, good, indifferent, normal, tragic. We just don't know. We don't know what's going to happen, so there's no way to orient ourselves to God based on any kind of predictability. We have to adjust. We have to be chaotic with our relationship with God. But the pattern still holds. We obey, and God blesses. And the blessing itself is peace and trust. And in our lives, that's just the natural result of obedience and loving God. It's peace and trust and not worrying about what's going to happen because God's got it under control. So this is the Bible verse that we use now pretty much all the time, and you probably have heard it and maybe get sick to death of it, but and we know that God causes everything to work together for the good of those who love God and are called according to his purpose for them. Now, what this passage doesn't mean is that everything happens for a reason. If any of you ever come to me and say, well, you know, everything happens for a reason, I might punch your face because everything does not happen for a reason. I do not believe that. I don't believe my son has cystic fibrosis for a reason. Like we're being taught something or no. I think that God can bring reason from what happens in our lives. So, Christian has cystic fibrosis, bad thing, but good things can also come from it. We learn empathy. We learn how to put ourselves in other people's shoes. We learn how to relate to God differently. But those are a result of what happened. That's not the reason it happened. God brings reason from the things that happen. Change isn't bad. A lot of people, well, that if you talk to some people in my office, they would say change is bad. But but change isn't bad. Change is just change. Chaos is change. And when change happens, sometimes good can happen, sometimes bad can happen, sometimes good can happen, but change is just change. And so if we approach it, if we approach our lives in that way, change is change, God is constant. Change is change, but God is constant. We don't question our relationship with God anymore when bad things happen, because bad things are going to happen. Life is unpredictable. And you guys will discover this. You may have already, some of you may have already discovered it, but life is unpredictable. You never know what's going to happen. Chaos could raise its ugly head any moment in your life. But when you have that constant relationship with God, you know that He's got it. He's got you. He's got you. We know He's going to be there with us no matter what. So here we are today. So this is where we are today. This is our hope. There's been recently DNA mapping that was completed. They, a few years ago, I can't remember exact year, but they discovered the exact gene where cystic fibrosis mutation happens. This was in the early 2000s that they discovered the exact gene that the cystic fibrosis mutation happens, which means they can target therapy to that specific gene, which is amazing to me that that can even happen. This random mutation that somehow occurred, now they've got a way to target that. And our hope is that they're going to come up with treatments that are so great that our son can live, you know, for a regular, normal life. There will never be a cure for cystic fibrosis because it is genetic, but they can come up with treatments that are so good that it seems like there's a cure. And actually, there is some drugs in the pipeline right now. So if you want to give to the Cystic Fibrosis Foundation, this wasn't supposed to be a plug for that, but if you guys ever feel like you want to take up a cause, cystic fibrosis is a good one. They've got some drugs in the pipeline right now. My son was actually a part of some clinical trials for these drugs that they hope will actually help that CTRF gene, which I didn't go into all that with you guys, but it will actually kind of make it like it's normal, and it would be amazing. So we're hoping that that will help. So this is my son today. This is Christian. He's 26. Do you remember what age I told you that the life expectancy was when Christian was born? 27. This is Christian today. This is my daughter's graduation last year. He lives a very healthy, active life. He's got friends. He's in weddings. He studied film, videography, film editing. This is him and his sister. This is exactly them. You guys, if you knew them, you would be laughing your heads off at this picture, because this is their personalities right here. She's all, and he's all, what? So this is the idyllic picture of them. But he's doing great. And this is our family 30 years later. And then this is a picture of my son from this past April. He was hospitalized for cystic fibrosis in April for the first time in his life. He had never been hospitalized for cystic fibrosis. So from the time he was a baby and we were concerned all through his whole life, never went to the hospital until he was 25 years old. And as a matter of fact, we went into the hospital and the people in the hospital were like, okay, so we're going to do the normal stuff. And Christian's like, what's the normal stuff? I don't need. And they're like, how old are you? And he said, 25. And they're like, you have never been in for cystic fibrosis before? And he said, nope. And they go, well, okay, this is what we're going to do. And so they laid it out for him. And he was basically in seclusion for 2 weeks. He had to be isolated. If you wanted to go into his room, he had to wear the mask and the gloves. So because he had some bugs in his lungs that needed to get out of there. And after 2 weeks, he said he was in for a lung spa. That's what he said. So he got his lungs all cleared out. And he's doing great. He lives in Michigan now with me. I just moved here 2 years ago. He just moved here this summer. So he's now here living with me and my husband. He'll never leave us. That's another chaotic issue that we'll talk about some other time. but this is our hope. This is our son. This is the genetic random selection that made him. He's a great kid. We love him so much. We couldn't imagine life without him. We tell him that all the time. And not only that, but we have taught our children the same relationship with God, that things can happen. Things are going to come up, things we don't know about, but God is constant. We obey and God blesses. And that is my presentation. So do you have any questions or anything that you can go ahead and clap. Go ahead and clap. I think we have about like 5 minutes. Do you guys have any questions that you'd like to ask? Cystic fibrosis, the relationship with God, anything that you that came to your mind while you while I was talking at all? Yes. Does it have to do with what? No, it's a medication that, I mean, I can try to describe this to you. So the part of cystic fibrosis that's the problem is the chloride release from different cells. In the lungs especially, they have what's called the CTRF. It's a chloride transmitter, and that is broken in CF patients. So that gene, that mutation that causes that to be broken. And so the drugs that they're working on now are trying to figure out a way to basically fix that chloride transmitter so that the chloride flows normally. They did try some gene like replacement kind of stuff, but they were having to use like a flu virus, and I guess that actually caused more problems than, you know, so it's not a real good fix for this particular because it's a lot of lung problems, so you can't really use a flu virus to fix something that's wrong with the lungs because that's a problem. So they were discovering more problems with that than they were solving. So this other therapy is they figured out that chloride is the real problem. So if they can fix the chloride, then they can fix that. Yes, ma'am. Oh. Okay. So that question was the therapies that they're coming up based on like gene replacement? And the answer to that is no. Any other questions? I wish I was more of an expert on what's coming in the treatment, but I do know that that is the case. Any other questions?